Stand Up for the Truth is sponsored by Lakeshore Communications Incorporated and made possible by your generous tax-deductible donations at standupforthetruth.com/donate. This is Stand Up for the Truth, a packed hour of challenging discussion addressing important issues and topics affecting Christians across the nation. Join the conversation via email at comments@standupforthetruth.com. Now, David Fiorazzo.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to another podcast, Stand Up for the Truth. It will be a challenging discussion today because we are going to be talking about Islam, the U.S. Constitution, and Muslims running for office, religious freedom, a lot of issues, the peace plan, refugee bans, and so much more. All always talking about these things through the lens of Scripture, trying to see the world with that biblical view. Father in heaven, thank you for giving us your word. Thank you that we can know the truth. And thank you, Jesus, that you clearly stated that you are not only the truth, but you are the way and the life. And we thank you for your word. We trust in your word, Lord. We thank you that we can stand on it. And that's what gives us our foundation of hope, of faith, and of to live in the present time. In these dark times, we have your word that lights our path as a lamp to our feet. We love you. We lift up this hour to you. We pray that whoever's listening right now would be encouraged and informed and possibly challenged in some cases. And we just praise you for the opportunity to do this podcast. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Dr. Ben Carson once said this, "I would not advocate that we put a Muslim in charge of this nation. I do not believe Sharia law is consistent with the Constitution in America." As we know, there are Muslims that have been elected to the U.S. Congress as well as local offices across the country. Is that a problem? The most recent Muslims elective have chosen to be sworn in, placing their hand on a Qur'an instead of the Bible. Are you okay with that? That's their prerogative, right? What about religious freedom? Is there a line to be drawn? Many have said the U.S. Constitution is one of the biggest reasons Islam has been able to expand and grow in America, from education, the public schools, to government. Well, today's guest, we're going to talk about that with Tony Gurule of Radical Truth. He's the vice president of Radical Truth. He's a full-time missionary, evangelist, speaker, and trainer. He's the host of Colliding Worldviews on the Aramaic Broadcasting Network's Trinity Channel. And previously, he hosted 180 episodes of Truth Matters with Rocio Christie. That was a television show. Tony is a community apologist who informs and equips both adults and youth, especially in the areas of evangelism, apologetics, and Islam. Tony, great to have you back with us. Happy New Year, brother. Haven't talked to you in a while.
It's great to be with you again, Dave. It's always great to be on your show, and I thank you for your work and for your listeners and their interest in this topic.
Well, it's important, and I think we need to come out of the some of us have been in denial, if we would admit the truth on this, and we need to be informed. We need to understand what's going on. We need to give people the benefit of the doubt, meaning refugees, Muslims that are coming to America just to start a new life, to have a good life. But we know there are also, radicals. There are those who would, there are extremists that would like to really do damage to people, to this country. And they, you know, different kinds of jihad. We want to talk about all that. First of all, let's get back to your ministry, Radical Truth. You had a lot of different videos, some phenomenal videos on your YouTube channel, and I believe you were you had some issues on either YouTube and or Twitter where you were either banned or censored, and you had to completely change where your videos were held. Could you tell us a little bit about what happened and where you're at now?
Well, Radical Truth, we still have our YouTube channel that is up and running just fine. However, I had a Vimeo channel, and I had used that for quite some time because I had heard about people having issues. Like, well, let me just go ahead and go with Vimeo from the get-go. And over the last few years of being on there, posting, I had over 400 videos, including the videos of the presentations that I've created and given publicly, which I recorded with narration so that people could see around the world. And everything was going fine. It was probably about a year and a half ago that I had received some type of notice that my channel was shut down or, you know, was censored in some way. However, I contacted the customer service and they said, oh, we see that your channel was accidentally, quote unquote, marked as spam. And we put something in place. And I figured that someone got mad, went to the channel and just hit spam on pretty much every single video in order to try to get it shut down, which it did temporarily. But then it was back up. But it was just about a month ago when all of a sudden someone said, oh, we can't find this video. I went again. I saw that same type of message that I saw about a year and a half ago. But this time I emailed them and no response. And it's interesting how this all happened just after the new year, after the new terms of service came out, which seems to be happening on every single platform out there for the most part, as they get more and more politically correct in their user terms and guidelines. Alternative voices are being pushed away from so many sites. So thankfully, BitChute.com, that is where my the new channel that I have uploaded all those 400 videos again yet. I'm working my way. The great thing about BitChute, which I've heard many other people go to as well, is that they actually quote the Human Declaration or the Declaration of Human Rights in their term any freer than that. And they don't allow is a very short list, and it's an off list. But at least it's not like the other places. So,
Tony, I want to go back to your Lights Out, When Islam Rules America. That was phenomenal. If we pull up our podcast that we did with you last year, I believe it was last November, what was it called? The podcast is called Radical Truth, Islam, Muhammad, and Middle East History. We have that program or that video, Lights Out, When Islam Rules America, and it's just right now, it's just a big black square that says, sorry, this video does not exist. We're going to have to put that back in there because that was on Vimeo, from what I understand. So it's no longer there. We need to put the new program and the new video in there, right?
Yes, everything on Vimeo is no longer there. What you want to do is go to bitchute.com. That is bitchute.com/TonyGurule. Gurule. And you'll find Lights Out, the presentation on the Muslim Brotherhood, the presentation on Islamic law. You'll see a number of other videos that I have uploaded there, as including the two interviews with Tommy Robinson, who has also been censored on social media, on Facebook. Greg, David, if you go to Facebook, if you put a post on there and Robinson's name, it will be flagged and it will tell you that they're dangerous individuals, quote unquote.
Well, let me just say this. I'm just going to go over to the Radical Truth Facebook page, and that is still up. But Tony, you're cutting out just a little bit, if you can hear me. But I am not on Chrome. I pulled up Mozilla, right? Firefox. And I typed in what you told me to type in, bitchute.com/TonyGurule. And this is what I've got. Just so you know how what people are finding when they're typing this in, it says, this site has been blocked by your network administrator. It's got a block policy there. Client IP address block reason says radicalization and extremism. Then it says, if you believe the above website is rated incorrectly, click here. So this is what we're getting when we're just typing that in. So I'm going to have to link that. And then it gives you an opportunity, I guess, to enter a verification code to try to get to your site. So there's a problem. You may have been flagged on BitChute as well, but we're going to try to use some of those direct links. Like you say, you have them over on the Radical Truth page. If I click on the BitChute link on your Facebook page, it goes right now. It's loading, and I see the video. So I got there. So I need to direct people to the Radical Truth Facebook page, and that's Radical Truth 777. On Facebook.
Yeah, another thing you can do, just go to radicaltruth.net, which is our main website. And then on the menu bar across the top, at least right now, we're having a little issue with the mobile version. So you actually have to be on an iPad or larger screen to see the full menu.
Okay.
But if you see the full menu, then you'll see one of the buttons says videos. If you click it, then it'll give you two options, our YouTube channel and then Tony's BitChute channel. And if you click on either one, it'll take you to those places.
Okay, so radicaltruth.net. And our listeners can easily find that one. But it's interesting, all this different technology. And this, all it is, we are trying to get the message of truth about the gospel, about what the Bible says compared to, in this case, what Islam and Muslims believe. It's very interesting. Are we going to have to take an early break or no? Okay, so we're going to keep going here. Let's get right into some of these questions I had for you, Tony. We talked at the very beginning of the broadcast of something that Ben Carson said when someone asked him about, I think at the time, a Muslim that was elected to office that was sworn in, putting his or her hand on the Quran instead of the Holy Bible. Most of the country didn't think much about that. Some of us thought, that's interesting. How far is this going to go? And then, he said he doesn't think Sharia law is consistent with the U.S. Constitution. I know that's your stance as well. More Muslims are running for office. More candidates are being elected. Is this a problem for America, or is it a good thing because we're a nation that believes in religious freedom?
Well, let me say, first of all, Dave, that our ministry, RadicalTruth.net, we're a Christian 501c3 organization, and we see Muslims as people made in the image of God who need the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
So whereas we do not sugarcoat Islam, and we definitely do expose it, we have that in what we do, is proclaim truth, share the gospel, and expose Islam. We don't sugarcoat it. We will tell people what Islam according to Muhammad is, and that's what people need to know. But at the same time, our message includes the ultimate solution. And before that, it just includes a solution in general, but most importantly, the ultimate one, which is the gospel itself. So we see Muslims as people who need the gospel, and that's what we focus on. At the same time, we don't sugarcoat Islam, and we also don't sugarcoat the agenda for the world. And of course, the world includes America, and that is that America is under Islamic law. That is the plan. That is why there are so many Muslim candidates running for political offices right now throughout the U.S., running for positions of power, because the goal is to have America under Islamic law. Now, as far as the putting the hand on the Quran or putting the hand on the Bible, either way, so a lot of people don't know that it's not required that people put their hand on the Bible when they're sworn in. There is no religious test, as the Constitution says. However, if someone is choosing to put their hand on something in general, and in particular on the Quran, then that tells you something, number one, especially if you have studied the Quran, studied Islamic theology, the Islamic worldview, Islamic law, etc., because you know that the goal is to have the whole world under Islamic law. And in America, we have laws and liberties, which people love, but these laws and liberties are also being exploited and used against us.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you criticize what they're doing, they will do what? They will bring up our own laws and liberties against us, saying, hey, this is a free country. Mm-hmm. We have freedom of religion, etc. Now, the thing is that there are people out there who say that Islam isn't a religion, it's a political ideology. I know where they're coming from.
Yes.
I know what they mean by that because I've studied Islamic law. However, it's not entirely accurate because there are definitely religious aspects to Islam, and there are many Muslims in the world who are not involved politically in anything and, in fact, don't even want to live under Sharia. But as far as a religious belief, Islam is all they know, and mainly that's because they don't know the gospel, of course. However, they pray five times a day. They fast during Ramadan. They try to make a trip to Mecca if they can sometime in their life. They give money to charity. And they do these things because they think that it pleases Allah. These are religious aspects of Islam.
Mm-hmm.
And praying five times a day, it doesn't matter if one Muslim in America does it or a million Muslims in America do it, praying five times a day does not infringe upon the Constitution and our Bill of Rights. So the religious aspects of Islam are protected by our founding documents. But as soon as you bring politics or the political aspects of Islam into the equation, that is when there is an issue, because Islamic law, or full Sharia, how it's implemented to both Muslims and non-Muslims in public, is not compatible with the American Constitution and Bill of Rights. And if anyone doubts that or doesn't know why that is the case, go to the BitChute channel and watch Unveiling the Facts of Sharia, because you'll learn all that you need to know about Islamic law, as well as a side-by-side comparison between American rights and rights for non-Muslims under Sharia.
And I want to encourage people to go to the Radical Truth Facebook page. You've got a lot of videos on there. And we do want to get to the Middle East peace plan that the Trump administration just tried to put forward, also the reaction to that. I do want to get to that, Tony, but not in this segment. I want to go back to the concept of our U.S. Constitution, and it is such a great asset, if for lack of a better word, to the furthering of Islam. It helps further the political Islam in the U.S. I watched that undercover video on your website. It was phenomenal, by the way. And for those of you that haven't seen this yet, it's a Jewish man who is fluent in Arabic. He goes undercover as a Muslim to interview and expose Islamists and their plan for Islamization of America and Europe. He went to Miami, went to Dearborn, Michigan, all over the place. But Tony, in that undercover video called False Identity, Israeli documentary on Islam in the West, this man was interviewing people, some of these leaders who said, we thank Allah for the U.S. Constitution and the freedom we have to do what they are called to do. I would love to share some of your thoughts on that. And it was just such a phenomenal video. It's quite intense. I mean, you're reading the subtitles in much of it, but I would love to have you just share some of the main bullet points from that undercover video.
Yeah, people are really sharing that a lot. If you go to the Radical Truth Facebook page and you scroll down, you'll see that video that you're talking about. There's a two-part video. Each one's 40 minutes long. They both have subtitles throughout, because when he came in speaking Arabic and he had a false passport and everything in order to infiltrate these different places, including CARE, of all places, Florida.
I know.
You see and hear the plan for America caught on video. And this is being, I mean, this has been shared, I don't know, probably 400 times already on Facebook alone. But if you go to the BitChute channel, it's there as well. It is the second and third newest videos that have been uploaded there. And I mean, there's no arguing with what is included in these videos. If you go to the Facebook page and you look and you find the post that we're referring to here,
right.
It says, if you know anyone who's still asleep, have them watch this, because it's all laid out, including it. You'll see in the video, the guy say in part two, he says, I'm running for commissioner. That's why we need more Muslims.
Wow.
All it's going to do is take time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they are very patient.
Yes.
This is not an ISIS patience. This is a Muslim brother.
I think that was that was an oxymoron, ISIS and patience in the same sentence.
Yeah.
But
and Dave, that's what people need to understand.
Uh-huh.
ISIS and the Muslim Brotherhood have the exact same end goal. The only difference is that ISIS is impatient and the Muslim Brotherhood is patient. Mm-hmm. The Muslim Brotherhood, which was founded 92 years ago in Egypt, and people can learn all they need to know about it by going to my BitChute channel and watching the Muslim Brotherhood, Origin, Identity, and Agenda, you'll learn the history behind it. They've been around 92 years, and they've come very far. And the Arab Spring that you heard about almost a decade ago, it was all about that. And the mainstream media in America didn't tell people what was actually happening with that. And if you watch Lights Out, When Islam Rules America, I'll talk about a book written by an American woman who lived in Egypt for decades, and she was there during the Arab Spring. And she says that when the mainstream media in America was just showing people the rioting and saying that all these people want is democracy and freedom, That was all a setup by the Muslim Brotherhood. And behind the scenes, they were actually changing the constitution in Egypt. They were demonizing police and filling the void with Islamic militias and doing all this. They're changing documents. They were arresting officials. They were doing all kinds of stuff. And compare that to what's happening in America currently. Watch Lights Out. That's what people need to watch. Lights Out, When Islam Rules America, and then watch this two-part undercover documentary that you're referring to, because it's all laid out. You have the plan. The goal is takeover. And the thing is, Dave, is that there are a ton of Islamists running for political offices throughout the United States right now. Now, let's just say that come election time, all of them lose. I mean, do people think that they're just going to think, okay, well, I lost, so I guess I'll, you know, that's it. This is just the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how many are going to be running in the future? How many are going to be running a year or two, 4 years from now? This is just the beginning, folks.
Yes.
And people need to realize what's happening and what the goal is. And if you just sit back and let it happen, it will happen because they're not going to stop.
Yes, Tony, we need to take a break. We're just going to make it easy for people. Go to the Radical Truth 777 Facebook page and scroll down to January 25th, and that is the post with the links to these videos. And I really encourage you, if you're listening right now and you don't have time right now, mark this. Go to this undercover video, False Identity, Israeli documentary on Islam in the West. Back with Tony Gurule and Radical Truth after this.
Your monthly financial support of StandUpForTheTruth.com is needed and appreciated. Now, back to today's Stand Up For The Truth with David Fiorazzo.
We're on the line with Tony Gurule of Radical Truth. Go to get all his videos or the links to them on their Facebook page and just search Radical Truth on Facebook. The phenomenal undercover video we're talking about, and I want to ask more questions about this. It's called False Identity, Israeli Documentary on Islam in the West. What fascinated me, Tony, is when he went and was just talking to, like, for example, in Dearborn, Michigan, where we're, from our perspective, that's just one state over from us. We're going, wow, they have pretty much taken over that community. And it's like the people were saying, it's like you're in the Middle East. You know, you have everything, all the stores, all the grocery, all the foods and everything, the mosques everywhere. But the police chief took this guy around, this Jewish man who was posing as a Muslim, took him around in the squad car, introduced him to people, business owners. And the idea I understood from that, Tony, was he was expecting the best of these people, giving them the benefit of the doubt, because for the most part, people were getting along and it was peaceful. But it seemed like he's kind of in denial about what they were actually, some of them were actually wanting to do when the guy would actually go in the mosque and interview them. Share a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, I mean, we can't expect a person in America who wants America to change towards Sharia to admit that in front of a police officer.
Yeah.
So the undercover Jew, you know, he gives his commentary. If you're watching it in hindsight, he's giving his commentary even on what the police officer was saying.
Mm-hmm.
How, you know, he says the police officer's in denial. Of course, he's hoping for the best. The police officer tells him, you know, that he's, oh, yeah, you know, if we were under Sharia, then this, you know, bacon factory wouldn't be right here and so on. And, you know, trying to convince him that it's not under Islamic law. And yet when he talks with people, even with the police officer there, you know, they will admit, yeah, I'd rather live under Islamic law. I'd rather live under Sharia. And that is the goal. And it'll just blow people away when they watch this. Dave, if you watch both parts of the video?
No, I just got the first one. That was enough for me to say, wow, okay. I've got to get this out.
Yeah, you got to watch the second one, because in that one, you're going to get another 40 minutes of more exposure of what's happening. Mm-hmm. I mean, people, they can't believe it. And I think that's why it's being shared so much, so rapidly. But people need to see it, because this is, again, the goal. This is what's happening. Now, I know there are people who think that Dearborn is a no-go zone, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. Like, non-Muslims are not allowed to go there. I have a friend who's lived there for 20 years, roughly.
Hmm.
He goes to the community college and open air preaches and shares the gospel.
Wow.
He has Bible studies on campus with Muslim students whenever he can. He does door-to-door evangelism in Dearborn. He does a lot of things that technically could not happen under Islamic law.
Hmm.
So it's not under Sharia. Yes, it's very Islamized. Yes, if you go there, there's a very high Muslim population. But Christians still have a lot of freedoms, at least for now. But it's not as bad as people think. Now, if you go out there and actually start criticizing Islam and all of that, then yeah, you're going to get definite blowback. But you know, maybe it's just because the way he does it. I mean, he's made videos saying, "I think Islam is false. I think the Bible is true." I mean, he'll admit what he says. You know, it could be his personality, the way he goes about it. But I just know that the Lord is really blessing his work there. That's been happening for over 20 years.
Wow!
And he does all these things and more. And the interesting part too, Dave, is that yes, the Muslim population there is very high, but the Muslim population is mainly Shia or Shiite, which is the actual minority Muslim group in the world. Because if you look at the whole Muslim population throughout the world, it's about 85 to 90% Sunni, and the rest mainly Shia, but there's also other groups in there too. So Dearborn, the capital, Muslim capital of the U.S., is mainly Shia. So that's an interesting aspect because mm-hmm. you have a group who is known to themselves to be a minority are the majority there. Now, I have talked with people who live there, who of Americans as well as people who grew up in the Middle East and now live in the Dearborn area. And I've asked them because I was wondering about that. I said, how do you think the atmosphere would be different if every Shia in this area were a Sunni? And I've had people who actually grew up in Iraq who live in the Dearborn area now tell me it would be like Europe. And if you've studied what Europe is like,
mm-hmm.
it's very aggressive compared to Dearborn. So that's an interesting aspect there because they're saying, okay, the Sunnis are that much more aggressive and the Shia / Shiite are more interfaithy. Even here in America, if you follow the different interfaith dialogues and mm-hmm. events that actually aren't happening as much as they were in the last 5 years, I think more people are catching on to it. And I think that the ummah as a whole in America is kind of moving forward to the next step, technically. But these interfaith dialogues are really pushed by Shias as well, not so much by Sunnis.
It's interesting that during the Obama administration, these interfaith dialogues were all over the place. And he was one that was quoted. He went to the Islamic Society of Baltimore in 2016, and he thanked, I'm not making this up, you can look up these articles, he thanked Muslim Americans for helping build this country and said, we are one American family. He said for more than 1,000 years, people have been drawn to Islam's message of peace. And the very word itself, Islam, which you and I understand as meaning submission, he said, Barack Obama said, Islam comes from salam, peace. And that's a standard greeting, peace be upon you. Would you like to clarify that? What is it, submission or what is Islam, the meaning of it? Is it peace like Barack Obama said?
Islam means submission. A Muslim is one who submits. Now, Dave, when people tell me or ask me, is Islam a religion of peace? I always ask them, what do you mean by peace?
Hmm.
Because people don't ask that. And if you watch Lights Out when Islam Rules America, you will learn, you will see a side-by-side comparison on different terms that are used in Islam and how those are defined by Islam versus how they're defined in America. And the terms that are defined are peace, freedom, justice, and human rights. Those are all defined differently under Islam. But if you never ask a Muslim or anyone who's using those terms, what do you mean by that? You're going to continually talk past one another. Because in Islam, it technically is a religion of peace, quote unquote. However, it doesn't mean peace and tranquility in the Western sense. In Islam, peace doesn't mean freedom. It means lack of opposition. in other words, as a area of the world comes to live under Islamic law, that is the house of peace, the Dar al-Islam. It's the abode of peace. It's the abode of Islam. It's where there is no opposition to Islam. So when an Islamist or anyone who knows their Islamic theology says Islam is a religion of peace, now they may not be lying to you. They may actually think that it's a religion of peace in the Western sense, simply because so many Muslims don't even study their primary sources. They don't even study the life of Muhammad. It's just a blind following of those five pillars.
Mm-hmm.
But what if you know your Islamic theology, when you say Islam is a religion of peace, what you're referring to is aslim taslim, which means submit and you will have peace. And you will learn that, as well as those other terms of peace, freedom, justice, and human rights, as well as mercy and all these different terms, mm-hmm. you will learn in Lights Out when Islam rules America.
I think that's one of the biggest things people can take away from this segment so far, and that you said when people suggest the talking point that Islam is a religion of peace, ask them, what do you mean by peace, or how would you define peace? That was excellent, Tony. Really quickly, before we talk about the peace plan, the Middle East peace plan that everybody's up in arms about, you have the second video, The Deception of Interfaith Dialogues, and as you say, it's not happening as much in the last couple of years as it was like 5 or 10 years ago. But it is something that people are saying, well, we should come together and unite with those who have common goals. That's interfaith, unity, right? How would you warn or caution against that idea?
All the interfaith dialogues are usually organized by mosques, by Islamic centers. They are organized by Muslims themselves, and then they will invite usually a liberal Jew, and then a Christian pastor, and you look into the pastor, and it's okay. He's like a pastor of a Unitarian Universalist church, basically, for the most part. And they come together, and they say how much they have in common, and that is the issue here, because it's not the similarities that matter; it's the differences. And whereas Jews and Christians agree on the history of the world as we know it, and that Abraham was a Jew, and you read the Bible up to, you know, all the world history, and we understand Judeo-Christian history and theology, that's not the case with Islam. In Islam, Abraham was a Muslim. So it's technically false, and it's known as the Abrahamic fallacy, to even say that Judaism, Christianity, and Islam are all Abrahamic religions, because they have a completely different Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the Abraham of history. It's a revisionist history, and that's what all Islamic history is. It's make-believe. They've rewritten history as we know it, wow. And everything outside of Islam contradicts Islam. I've been telling people who've been trying to debate online and stuff, like, oh, you know, they believe this too, they believe this too. If you look to everything outside of Islam, I mean, you look at Jewish sources, Roman sources, all these different sources from antiquity, they all technically back up the Judeo-Christian worldview. They don't back up, you know, Christian theology per se, but at least the Judeo-Christian history of the world as we know it. It all contradicts Islam, Islamic theology, and Islamic claims to world history. So these interfaith dialogues are deceptive because they focus on the similarities when it's the differences that matter.
Yes.
Because the Abraham, the Adam and Eve, the Abraham, the Moses, every prophet that we find in the Bible, Jesus himself, they were all Muslims according to the Islamic worldview. They are not the same people. So it's a deceptive thing to say, look at what we have in common, as if these few things make us all believe the same. Mm-hmm. We don't. And that's why so many people in America are deceived by this westernized, watered-down, sugar-coated Walt Disney version of Islam that has nothing to do with what Muhammad actually taught and how Islam is actually practiced in other countries. And that's the only reason why people are appealed to it here in America.
Amen. And as you said, a lot of Muslims today, nominal Muslims, I guess you could define some of them, they haven't even read the biography of Muhammad. And I want you to clarify, Tony, we have a lot of newer listeners, and we haven't talked about this specifically in a while. Let's just take the person of Jesus, who to us is God and divine and the Word made flesh. What do Muslims believe about Jesus?
They believe that he is not the eternal Son of God incarnate. He is a man who had a beginning, similar to what Jehovah's Witnesses believe, is that he was created. Mm-hmm. Yeah, not just the body, but the personhood was created. He's not an eternal person in human flesh. They believe that he is a prophet. If you say he's the Son of God, some Muslims will say, "Oh yeah, well, many people are called the Son of God. David's called the Son of God." So they you know, basically have a different interpretation of what Son of God means. That's why you want to refer to him as he did himself, as the Son of Man. That's very helpful when you're talking with Muslims. But he did not die on a cross. And of course, if he didn't die on a cross, he didn't rise from the dead either. Right. And Islam teaches that he is coming back, but he's actually coming back to destroy Christianity. Huh. Because the Jesus, quote unquote, of Islam, he's known as Isa, I-S-A, in the Quran. He's only mentioned, he's mentioned way more than Muhammad is. When you look to it, it's very interesting because there are many similarities and there's many things that the Quran says about him that get a lot of Muslims thinking if they just read the Quran and they meditate upon it. Because even in the Quran itself, he's on a pedestal compared to Muhammad. And even in the Quran itself, there are many similarities between Isa, the Islamic Jesus, quote unquote, and Allah. And you can use this as well. And another video that people should watch on the BitChute channel is Fabricating Jesus, How the Cults Distort the Gospel of Christ. Because in there, you'll learn about Jesus from the Islamic perspective, as well as the Mormon and Jehovah's Witness perspectives, and some tips on how to reach them with the gospel, and some apologetics in there as well. And the main thing that people need to understand, whether it's an interfaith dialogue or when you hear Muslims say, "Oh, we love Jesus," again, it's a completely different Jesus. He wasn't a Jew; he was a Muslim. It's a revisionist, recycled, rewritten view of history as we know it.
Wow, so much more to get to, Tony. This hour is flying by, but we need to take a break. We come back, we are going to talk about a couple different things, God willing, and that is some of the new challenges that the Trump administration travel ban is facing in federal appeals court, and the fact that the Palestinians rejected the Trump peace plan, the Middle East peace plan, before it was even rolled out. But there are some interesting things in that plan. We'll talk about that and get Tony's perspective when we come back.
Thank you for listening and sharing today's show via StandUpForTheTruth.com/podcast. Now, back to Stand Up For The Truth. Here's David Fiorazzo.
We're talking with Tony Gurule of Radical Truth. Check out his Facebook page and get all the links to the latest videos he's got that are phenomenal. And that is Radical Truth 777 on Facebook. Now, I want to just share Pastor Jack Hibbs' quote on what the Middle East peace plan. He said, "President Trump's continued involvement in the preservation and protection of both Israel and its neighbors is being played out in his foreign policy approach. Historically and biblically, Jerusalem has always been the capital of the nation of Israel. Unfortunately, President Mahmoud Abbas and his Palestinian partners yet again have failed to take advantage of a start. Until both sides embrace a starting point, a Middle East peace plan will continue to end prematurely." Now, one of the first articles, many articles we had that came out on the Palestinians rejecting the Trump administration peace plan, but one, some of the headlines said, "Palestinians reject Trump peace plan before it's rolled out." Tony Gurule, I'd love to get your take on this. I've got the Wall Street Journal article, many other articles on some of the contents of the peace plan, a lot of history, some speculation. But what are your thoughts on this?
Oh, man, where do I begin? what I'm going to do, Dave, is I'm going to send you a link that you can post for everyone as a resource.
Great.
And what this is, let me get the title here. This is the Covenant of the Islamic Resistance Movement, Hamas. And this was published in 1988. And this will let you know why no peace plan will ever work and will ever be accepted if the Jews are a part of it in any way other than getting kicked out, because they want this territory for themselves and they don't want double the current territory, which is part of this current peace plan. They don't want the $50 billion or however, you know, was going to be given to do renovations and build and all this other stuff. This is the best peace plan they've ever had from different presidents, and yet it's been rejected. Why? Because let me get to the spot here. But however, one thing that people need to know is that if any territory of the world has ever been under Islamic rule, then according to Islamic theology, that is still owned by Muslims and it's still theirs. So whereas Muslims had invaded that territory through Islamic jihad and then it was taken back by the Crusaders, they think, and then even today, they're like, oh, well, no, it's still ours because we ruled it at some point in history. So that's the belief right from the get-go. But chapter 3, the strategy and means, let me read this first part here. The Islamic resistance movement maintains the land of Palestine is waqf, land, given as endowment for all generations of Muslims until the day of resurrection. So they believe that is theirs, and they believe that they will take it over again, and they want that territory. It's not about land. I mean, Saudi Arabia could give them a huge piece of land and say, hey, come here and live here and, you know, do whatever you want to do. It's not about that. It's about the particular territory. So they're going to continually knock down any peace plan at all if the Jews are a part of it. In this document, I'm gonna give you the link to.
I've got it. I pulled it up. It's the website is the Middle East Media Research Institute.
Yeah, Memory.
Yep.
And they are quoting the Quran. They're quoting Hadith. They're quoting, the parts where it's talking about the end times when Muslims are going to be killing Jews and all of that.
Wow.
You know, there's Islamic theology behind the denial of this peace plan. And you know, it was President Sadat of Egypt years ago, who, as an Egyptian president, was actually supportive of the nation of Israel. And what happened to him? He was assassinated during a military parade. So this current leader of Palestine, which is a whole other topic we can go into, because as many people use it today, that's a fairly recent term. You know, you don't find Palestine, quote unquote, in the Bible. What you hear about and you read about, even from Genesis, is the Philistines. And the Jews had risen up in the year AD 130. And the Roman emperor, shortly after that, started calling the area Palestine. And he was actually doing it in a way to subjugate Jews and erase their history and all of that. That is where the term was really kind of taking hold. And when it first came back, it was actually the term Palestinians was actually used by Jews themselves to reclaim their identity. It was in the last 50, 60 years that it started being used as a non-Jew slash Arab term. So the way that many people use it today, especially a lot of young people who are saying free Palestine and running around yelling, they have no idea. I mean, they have no clue about world history and how this term is used. You know, if you go to Israel and if you go to the Palestinian territories, you will see maps and they say Palestine. They say that instead of Israel. Again, the modern day thing here is just making a distinction between Jews and non-Jews. And they call it Palestine, but again, it's a fairly recent term for the most part. Even when the Jerusalem Post first started, if I recall correctly, the Jerusalem Post was called the Palestine Post.
Really?
And in a museum or something there, I have to look at the details here. But basically, again, it was a term that they used for themselves as they reclaimed their identity. And again, it's more of a recent thing where it's been spun. Now, here's the thing too. Okay, not only is it just by default the fact that Islam is false if Christianity is true, but if we look in the Bible, we don't find Palestine, quote unquote. Now, from an Islamic perspective, they're going to say, "Oh, well, Islam is true, right? Yeah, Islam is true. Islam is the true religion of the world. Judaism and Christianity are just distortions of the original religion of the world known as Islam, and this is official Islamic Orthodox theology here." Dave, if Palestine is the place and that is the true name for it, well, we should definitely expect that to be mentioned in the Quran, right?
Yes.
But Palestine is mentioned zero times in the Quran.
Wow.
Philistines are mentioned zero times in the Quran. So you would think that Allah would have thought that was important since it's such a huge issue nowadays, you know. And again, people just don't understand the history there. And this is just another reinvention and another revisionist history of the world. And again, that's going to be another whole show in all of itself. So
absolutely. We'll learn more about this. And I think, thank you for that link. I'm going to put that in the blog post at standupforthetruth.com along with your videos. But a quote from a Clarion Project article, anyone who still has delusions that the Palestinian leadership is interested in peace and nation building, as opposed to terror and abject destruction, should check out the official Palestinian Authority's reaction to President Trump's as yet to be revealed peace plan. So this article came out before the peace plan was even revealed. But quickly, we only have about 5 minutes left. And Tony, you shared an article on your Radical Truth Facebook page from Time magazine, which I rarely share anything from Time, Newsweek, CNN, MSNBC, Huffington Post. Sometimes you have to. But this one says Trump's travel ban faces a new challenge in federal appeals court. And I just wanted to get your take. You mentioned you were talking about the countries in the travel ban that they're not exactly all Muslim countries. Could you explain that?
Yeah, the countries on the travel ban list are Iran, Libya, Somalia, Syria, Yemen, North Korea, and Venezuela. But if you look at the overall population of Muslims in the world and what countries have the most Muslims, those are Indonesia, Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, Nigeria, and Egypt.
None of the others.
So if this was an official Muslim ban, quote unquote, then the list would be different than what it actually is. And if people do the research, you can find that the countries that are listed were based on terrorist activity, a failure of the countries to properly document their own travelers, and insufficient efforts to cooperate and share information with U.S. authorities. So that is why the particular countries are on there. Now, as you see in that post as well, it says that in Sahih al-Bukhari, Volume 4, Book 52, Hadith number 220, Muhammad said, "I have been made victorious through terror." So if Muslims throughout the world try to emulate Muhammad, then not only should we not be surprised of what they do, but also, yeah, they're going to help get their country on that list because it's based on terrorist activity. So a whole nother issue there as the travel ban and all of that. Now, here's another aspect too, Dave, I wanted to bring into the whole Palestine-Israel thing.
Sure.
If people read the Bible and you actually get a biblical map and a modern-day map and compare those and you do the research there as far as territories and all of that, the land that God gave to Israel was from the Nile River in Egypt to Lebanon, south and north, and everything from the Mediterranean Sea to the Euphrates River, east and west. And modern-day Israel doesn't even include that. The territory that God promised to the nation of to the Israelites was all of modern-day Israel, plus the West Bank and Gaza, which are current Palestinian territories, quote-unquote, plus some of Egypt and Syria, plus all of Jordan, and even some of Saudi Arabia and Iraq. This is the territory that God promised to his people. So if anyone should be complaining, it should be the Jews.
Yes.
Because they don't have the territory that God promised them.
Exactly.
And instead,
yeah, go ahead.
But instead, you have the Muslims bashing the Jews as they've done for 1400 years because Muhammad was the founder of Islamic Jew hatred. And that is going to continue because of the Islamic worldview and Islamic theology. And that is why, while we don't sugarcoat Islam and we tell you like it is, and this is what every person in the world needs to know, especially Americans, because of the threat of the political aspects of Islam, the solution here is the gospel.
Amen. Amen.
That is the solution.
Yes.
If you want to see mosques emptied, share the gospel with the people who walk inside.
Hmm.
And I can tell you right now, there's definitely a fear factor there because of spiritual warfare.
Yes.
But the average Muslim in America is much more prepared to hear the gospel than the average Christian's prepared to share it.
Hmm. Wow.
The gospel is what is needed here. The gospel is the solution here. Because you have people in America who don't care anything about any religion, Christianity or Islam. They just want this political threat to end. And they say, hey, we need to just round them up and ship them back to their countries.
Right.
Like, they're not going to make their way back. Like, they're not going to come here again and try to do what they're currently doing. That's why we say the goal, the solution here, the ultimate solution is the gospel itself. And we will tell atheists that, we will tell Christians that, and we, of course, continually share the gospel with Muslims because God loves them. They're people made in his image. They believe in God, but they have a false God. It's not the God of the Bible. They believe in Jesus, but it's a false Jesus. Right. It's not the Jesus of the Bible. And they don't know or understand the gospel. My Christian friends out there, your average Muslim is not an expert on Christianity and will have a comeback to everything you say.
Mm-hmm. Right.
For the most part, they've never even heard the gospel. And if they have, they don't understand it.
Right. That's
so
our job.
So you just need to know some apologetics, some basic apologetics, and be confident and let them know that you love them enough to share the truth with them, and God will do the work from there.
Tony Gurule, Radical Truth, thank you so much. We're going to have to continue this, especially the part about the deception of interfaith dialogues. But you can get more information on Tony on his Facebook page, Radical Truth, plus radicaltruth.net, and we'll put all these links in the podcast post. Tony, God bless you, brother. We appreciate the work that you're doing. We'll talk to you next time.
Thank you so much, Dave.
You're welcome. When we come back, an exciting guest tomorrow. We'll talk about that in a minute.
Stand Up for the Truth, a ministry of Lakeshore Communications Incorporated. Keep the discussion going on social media. Stand Up WI on Facebook and Twitter. Now we wrap up today's Stand Up for the Truth.
Please remember to share our podcast. And tomorrow's guest, excited to have Laura Perry, former transgender, and there are a lot of them out there. She's got a book, Transgender to Transformed. So it's going to be an exciting program tomorrow with Laura Perry. God bless you and keep speaking the truth about things that matter.